Hey everyone, I just wanted to make a instructional orientation video for the EHR or the electronic health record through ATI. I know that some schools are using this and some may not be familiar with it, so I just wanted to share my screen and kind of show you how to navigate it and how to work it. So let me go ahead and pull that up. Share screen. Let's see, okay, first, let's see if I can pull my face here. You're going to go to the ATI site, ati.testing.com. I'm going to log in, sign in. Okay, now what you're going to do is it might look different depending if you're an instructor or a student. You can always click the student view. But I'm just going to do it this way just to get to the HR. So I click products over here, and then I'm going to go to manage products. And again, this is my instructor view. I'm not sure exactly what the student view looks like, but it should look similar. And once I get to manage products, it's going to have all these different options. I'm going to scroll down till I get to EHR Tutor. Right here, I'm going to go all the way across and click this plus sign. That's going to open up the course activities, the modules, course activities. And then you have to click this little clipboard check thing. A lot of clicks to get to it. Okay, now it's opening up the EHR Tutor. Okay, so let me see if I can maximize this. All right, so now we're going to go to the course list, and this is the cohort that I do Thursday clinicals with my students. This is me. My enrollment key is here. So I'm going to click go to course because this one's specific to me, where I'll have all my students under as well. So the students will have to put in that enrollment key to be under my cohort. So now on the screen, you can see it has different assignments or activity names. So we have orientation practice, which is the first one. This one's just kind of like, it's not an assignment per se. It's just you can go on and practice what it would feel like to create a new patient and fill in the information. So it's kind of like a playground. You kind of like go in and play with it and not have to worry about like turning anything in. Now the assignments, week one, week two, three, four, five, six, and seven, these are where the actual paperwork is going to be turned in. So I'm going to go under, just pick something random, week two. Actually, let me do it as a student view so you can see what that would look like. So you would, this is what the student's view would look like. Course name, you would select a course, and this is where you'd pick the cohort that you would be under, and that's me again. So every student's gonna be assigned an instructor, and I'm that instructor. So we'd click that, and then now it's the same thing. So they have orientation practice, week one, week two, so forth. So I'm gonna click week two and show you how to create a new patient. So you can see here where it says the due date, due before 10/24 at, you know, at midnight. It does lock you out, so you won't be able to do any more charting after that due date. So make sure you turn it in, and it will tell you what exactly they want you to do for this week. They want you to do a head-to-toe assessment, do some nursing notes every 2 hours, get your eyes and nose, and two sets of vitals. And every week is going to have a different requirement what you have to do, so make sure you just read. It builds on each other, so at least in the class that we're doing, like week one's the easiest and it builds. And then by week seven, you're doing a lot more charting. This is just kind of get you to get used to it. So we're going to click new inpatient chart right here. And so now you have to create a patient. You can't do anything else until you create a patient. So patient name, obviously if it was a real patient, you wouldn't want to put their actual name because that'd be HIPAA. Right there says do not place any HIPAA in this chart. So you could make up a name or just use a patient initials. This is my name, so I'm just using it for the demo. But you could put like GB, you know, for patient initials, so that wouldn't be violating HIPAA. And you just fill it out all the way through. My preferred pronoun is her instructorship. So you just have to fill out all of these things before you can move on. Comments, you can write anything else here. For my students, this is where you're going to put the pathophysiology for their diagnosis. So if your patient is, for example, a diabetic, you would put down the pathophysiology in this space, you know, explaining what's happening at the cellular level with diabetes, what organs involved, you know, the role of insulin, the pancreas, and all of that. So for my students, that's where I want you to put the patho based on their diagnosis. Then you just push save. It's kind of annoying because this support button is right there. So you have to like scroll just enough to avoid hitting the support button, push save. And then now you're at your dashboard. So this is where the patient's name is going to be, female, 30 years old. This is the just kind of like the patient summary. So you see that the patient summary is highlighted. This is read only. So like nothing is filled out yet because I haven't filled anything out. So it doesn't have a primary concern. It doesn't have any vital signs. But when I start plugging them in, it'll show up on this main page and it's just like a quick overview. You can't actually click or enter data on this page. So if I wanted to like insert some vital signs, I can't do it here because there's nothing to click. What you do is you have to go to flow sheets and click this little down arrow. And now you have all these different flow sheets, right? And then you'll click vital signs. So go ahead and go to vital signs and make sure that when you go to put them in that you're paying attention to the time, right? So like if you're a student and let's say your clinicals were yesterday on Monday and you took vitals at 8 a.m., but you get home and you don't chart it until the next day, Tuesday, and like right now it's 5:22, right? So that's gonna be the timestamp that shows up. So make sure you're changing it to reflect, you know, whatever time it actually was. So if, let's say it was Monday at 8 a.m., you want to make sure to change that and have it be accurate. You can put, you know, your values in here, fill everything out. Blood pressure, you know, I'm just making up some values. So you would put obviously the ones that are true for your patient. You can skip this. I don't require that, the mean arterial pressure. Room air for me, I'm just making up stuff. I'm pretending that I'm my own patient. So when it comes to pain, if they are verbal, like they can talk, you want to do the numeric pain rating. If they can't, if they're like, you know, on a ventilator or they're nonverbal, then you would do the faces, which shows like happy all the way to crying, and you would just rate what their pain is based on their face. Glucose monitoring, let's pretend my blood sugar was 70, and any comments that would happen, maybe like, no BP on left arm, you know, maybe they have a fistula or something, so you'd want to write that down. The rest of this, like the height and weight, the BMI, I don't require that, so you can just leave that blank or save. Okay, so now that that's saved, whenever you save something, it kicks you right back. Whenever you save it, it'll show you the completed information that you filled out. So if I want to like edit it, I can click this button. If I did something wrong and I want to change it, you'll notice I can't add anything. If I want to add something new, like a different time, like maybe I want to add in the lunchtime vitals, you have to do a new entry and then make sure to change that timestamp. So here you can see everything that you've charted. You can also go back to the patient summary, and now those will show up on that summary page. So now we see the vital signs that I just plugged in. But again, you can't chart anything there. You have to go to the flow sheet. So I want to show you how to do the head to toe assessment. So go back to flow sheets and you'll click assessment. And make sure you're clicking save. If I put in a bunch of information and then just clicked another tab without saving, you'll lose everything that you did. Again, pay attention to your timestamp here. Make sure you change it to reflect the accurate time that you did do your assessment, right? Head and face, you know, just fill it out as best as you can. we want to avoid clicking anything that says WDL or within defined limits or within normal limits, just because we're nursing students and we want you to get used to using proper nursing terminology. So some of these options will say WDL. Don't click those. We want you to actually to say like clean, dry, intact, rather than just WDL. So head and face, we'll say head round and symmetrical. You can click more than one thing. So click everything that applies. You know, anterior fontanelle is really just for babies. You can skip that. Neck, you can, you know, full range of motion, whatever, without swelling. Trachea is midline, whatever. So you go through ears, nose, and throat. I'm not going to go through all of it. Neuro, you know, level of consciousness. You know, this is where you ask them, like, are they alert and oriented times three or four, what have you. Orientation, here you go. So you go through everything, pupils. Just fill out what you can. Don't worry about the deep tendon reflexes. We're not doing that in the hospital. And then you can put comments, you know, at the bottom. If anything was abnormal, if you have anything additional to say about it, like, oh, maybe they were alert to a person, but they were confused with everything else. You could put that as a comment there. Maybe they didn't know who they, you know, where they were or what year it was, but they could tell you their name. Glasgow Coma Scale, respiratory, everything here. I don't think there's anything on here that needs clarification. Everything is pretty straightforward. See, there's an example of WDL within defined limits. So we don't want to do that. If when you're a nurse, you can do that, but in nursing school, we want you to get used to using words like regular rhythm, you know, what else? Yeah. So just avoid using WDL. If we see that, you're not going to get points for it. Cardiac, peripheral vascular. So this is right upper extremity, left upper extremity, and you're just looking at, don't pick WDL, capillary refill, you know, if they have a good pulse. And again, you can pick several things. So look, and then when you're done, you just click out, and now I have three things saved there, right? Tegumentary, Braden scale. So this is part of the head-to-toe assessment. This is looking at their skin, you know, their moisture, activity, mobility. This is determining whether or not they're at risk for, you know, pressure ulcers, risk level. This will tell you like, oh, they're high risk or mild risk type of thing. Musculoskeletal, their movements. This is the fall scale. So like to determine if someone's a fall risk, you know, have they had history falling? No. And you go through all the questions and they'll give you an answer. GI, GU, pain. You fill it out, and there's always a place to put comments, so utilize that. And then when you're done, push save. Don't forget to push save, or else you'll lose everything, which would not be fun. Please wait. Okay, good. Okay, so now it's saved. Now it will show you everything that you've charted, right? So obviously didn't fill out the whole thing. You can look over what you did. If you got anything wrong, you can edit it over here. Or you can do a new entry, but only one head to toe is required. Let's see what else. Let's go back to the patient summary. So you'll notice that primary concern, there's nothing listed. The patient's primary concern is like the main reason that they're in the hospital. Like, are they here because, you know, they were in a motor vehicle accident and they have like several body fractures? That would be their primary concern. Like, are they here for, you know, COPD exacerbation? That's their primary concern. They might have like 20 different diagnoses, right? A lot of people have a lot of things going on, but that's not what the primary concern is. The primary is like why they're at the hospital, like what brought them in. And technically, like in real life, nurses wouldn't fill that out. That'd be a doctor's thing because we're not medical doctors. We can't make a medical diagnosis, right? So the physicians would be the one to fill that out. But for the sake of, you know, the paperwork, so that I, as the instructor, can know like what the patient's problem is, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and fill that out. So you'll find that under the provider tab. That's like the doctors and the physicians. So in real life, you would not actually fill this out. So you go to chief complaint, history of present illness. You don't worry about the history of the review of systems. Review of systems is basically like a full head to toe assessment that's more in depth than what we do as nurses. So go to chief complaint, and then, here's the admission problems, right? So here's what you would put the primary concern. So let's say motor vehicle accident, several fractures. You can put whatever their main reason is for coming. And then other problems, diagnoses like, oh, history of hypertension, type 2 diabetes mellitus, whatever. Don't worry about the rest of it, history of present illness. You know, the chief complaint, you know, can be, you can ignore that, but what that would basically be is like, if I came in and I was like, oh, my wrist hurts, and they did an x-ray and they found out that my wrist was broken, that would be the chief complaint. Like, the reason I came to the hospital, right, is like, well, my wrist is hurting. Like, I said that as a patient. That's the complaint that the patient is making. And this, the primary concern diagnosis, is what the doctors found out. So they found out my wrist is hurting because I have several fractures, right? So you scroll down and save it. And now if you go back to patient summary on the left, that's going to show up here. Primary concern, motor vehicle accident, several fractures. So now I, as the instructor, know, like, by looking at your paperwork, I guess it's not technically paperwork since it's online work. I don't know. That sounds funny. I know what's going on with them, right? So like, I can just see it. I don't have to wonder. Sorry, that's my dogs barking in the background. Okay. What else? Let's keep going. You'll have to put in probably labs at some point. So you want to go over to the options here, go to results, and you're going to click on labs. And you're going to, here's all the options, right? So they have everything already like populated for you. So you can scroll down and see all the different things. You just fill in what's applicable. So like, oh, they did a blood glucose. Your blood sugar was 70. And it gives you a little reference range here on the side. It'll tell you normal, you know, 60 to 110, or fasting and non-fasting. What else? All sorts of labs here. So PTT, pH, oxygen, bicarb, all sorts of different things. The nice thing about this too is that you don't have to put just a numerical value. You can put a comment. So like here, it'll tell you the white blood count. It'll tell you a reference range over here, 4 to 10. So let's pretend my white blood cells were 15, right? What I want you to do here, because it's just kind of a waste of time just to like, you know, plug in all of these numbers without having like any critical thinking, or like, okay, what does that mean, or why do I care, right? Otherwise, just mindless, tedious, you know, filling in stuff that doesn't matter. I want you to write down like if it's high or low. So put in the number, you put high, and then I want you to put what could be possibly causing this and what you're going to do about it. Not necessarily what you will do about it, because that's not up to you as a student, right? But like something that you could potentially do. So white blood count is high. Let's be like, okay, depending on what's going on my patient, why could this be? It's like, well, patient has, you know, several. Hey, sorry about my dogs. I really am. There's another dog walking outside, so they're very upset about it. So patient has several fractures, open wounds, abrasions from the motor vehicle crash. And we know that that's, you know, compromised skin integrity, an opening for bacteria to come in. So compromised skin, or barrier, I should say, for bacteria, so forth. So like you're explaining like why it could be that this person seems to have an elevated white blood count, and what you're going to do about it. Like, okay, this person, how do we deal with this? Like patient could go on some antibiotics. Patient needs antibiotics, or if they have a fever with the infection, maybe some Tylenol. You know, just things like that. So just want to see that your critical thinking is working. This doesn't have to be necessarily the right answer or what they're actually doing, but I want you to like work through it. Like, okay, why does it make sense for these lab values to be occurring with my patient? Maybe my hematocrit is low. So we'll say, you know, 34, and it's like, well, massive blood loss, you know, when I was bleeding out my motor vehicle accident, you know, so maybe I need blood transfusion. maybe some iron supplements or something. So you see what I mean? Just want you to talk about why it could be happening and what to do about it. And you'll save it. And you'll see that those comments are there. So I'll be able to see if you put something there or not. Okay, next let's look over allergies. Got to make sure you put in the patient's allergies, and that should be, you know, easily accessible information. So you're going to go here. It doesn't really matter what time. You can just leave it, whatever. Add allergen, and I'm going to say, I'm allergic to sulfa drugs. And then reaction, let's say hives. Don't worry about the date allergy noted. And then you're going to put allergen added. And then save. Should show up. Yeah, so there it shows up there in my little patient banner, allergy, sulfa drugs. And then I think you can add another one. Let's say maybe they're also allergic to, I don't know, maybe I'm allergic to morphine. And what's my reaction? Anaphylaxis. And then allergen added, right? So save, and then that should show up in my patient summary. You can go up here and put read more, morphine and sulfa drugs, right? So make sure you fill out those allergies. What else? For nurses' notes, those are gonna be over on the tab here, just right under notes. There's nothing here just yet, but we're gonna go click new note. Our role as a nurse is a nursing note. Now there's two ways that you can do this, the easy way or the more correct way. The more correct way is, again, make sure you take note of the correct time. So let's say my clinicals were yesterday on the 3rd and my first note is going to be at like 7:30 a.m., right? And then I would put, you know, introduced, wow, I'm having a hard time typing today. Introduced self to patient, head to toe assessment, completed at this time, no signs and symptoms of distress, vital signs stable, whatever. And then you would click sign, right? And then now here is my first note, right? You can't see what it is, but if you click little plus sign, it will populate and it's associated with that 7:30 time. Now you can do it that way and make each individual note for the whole day and have to go in and create a new note for, like, you know, 9 o'clock and do it just like that. And then I'm going to have to click each one of these plus signs to read it. Or the easy way is just going to be to click new note and then just ignore the time and date, right? And then just make a list all in one note. Since you probably have it already written down in your paper and you're just transcribing it, it's probably going to be easier to do it this way. So just write 0730 and then write your note and then do a return and click 0900 and, you know, do your note, and then, you know, 12 o'clock and so forth. Just doing it all on one rather than having to create like several. And I think that's going to be a lot easier. And then go ahead and sign it. It'll be easier for you and also easier for me. So that all I have to do is just open up one of these and it's all going to be there rather than having to click like 10 of these little things and reading them all. So I don't care which way you do it. I mean, I would prefer you do it the easy way, but if you do the other way, I won't be mad. okay, let's see what other flow sheets there are. Oh, another thing about nurses' notes is if you do it the easier way, doing it all at once, make sure you're doing military time, right? So after 12 o'clock, I could have done something at 2 o'clock. Don't put 2 p.m., put 1400, right? Just a little side note. All right, what else is under flow sheets? Let's see if there's anything else in there we need. Vital signs, we talked about. Assessment, we talked about. Don't worry about the other screen scales. Okay, eyes and nose are going to be here. We can click that. Okay, so eyes and nose. Oral, let's say I drank 500 mls. It's got oral here and everything under there is oral. They've got IV. So maybe I had a bag of saline, 1,000 mLs. And then, you know, what's my output? So voided urine, 300, whatever, what have you. Pretty straightforward. There's comments. If you can be like, oh man, I was really concerned about the urine because it was bloody, you might want to put that there. Save. And those results will show up there. The other thing that's kind of different, let's talk about the daily care. So go ahead and click that. The daily care is convenient because a lot of the things that you would want to do in a nurse's note are under this tab. So one of the big purposes of nurse's notes is to cover yourself, protect your license. Obviously, you know, transfer important information, you know, to the rest of the healthcare team so they can read it and understand what's going on if there's something important that happened so everyone can read it, but also to cover your license, right? So a lot of it's about safety and things like that. So like armbands, obviously, do they have their patient ID, you know, with their name and date of birth? Do they have an allergy wristband? Do I have my sulfa and morphine allergy wristband? Hopefully, if I'm a fall risk, do I have that wristband? So that sort of thing. And you would verify that those patients have those things. Safe environment. You know, is my call light within reach? Is my personal belongings within reach? Is my bed in low position? Let's see, my side rails up times two. What else? If there's a bed alarm, if I'm one of those patients that need a bed alarm, that'd be on personal alarms on, and then you have to specify that later. So it would be like bed alarm, right? Bed alarm. Mobility, are they up ad lib or do they need help walking in the hall? Are they up to chair, whatever, up ad lib type of thing? So a lot of these things will give you a lot of good things to remember because like this, especially the safety part, this is super important to your license. You'll notice that this is all timestamped again. So the thing is that you don't want to just do this one time. You can't just chart that you checked that their call light is within reach at like 7 a.m. and then you didn't check it again the rest of the day, right? Because that's several hours have gone by. If let's say their call light becomes out of reach, you know, and then they fall and then they do an interview on the patient about why they fell. And they're like, oh, well, I was trying to reach all my belongings. And they'll be like, well, why wasn't the call light within reach? And they go back and look at your charting and see that the last time you charted on it was like at 7 o'clock and they fell at like 5 p.m. Right. So that's not going to look good for you. And that might get you in trouble. So fill this out once in the morning, you know, like for your like 7:30 or 8 o'clock or whenever it is that you first go into the patient's room. But then make sure you're charting on this stuff. You can either, you know, fill out one of these daily cares every 2 hours, which may or not be tedious, or you can make sure to write down these things in your nurse's notes where you do it all at once every 2 hours. So yes, you do need to go check on your patient and at least lay eyes on them every 2 hours, right? Even if you don't have anything to do for them, you need to peek in that patient's room and be like, hey, are you okay? You know, verifying that they're in bed, they're not on the floor, right? They haven't fallen out, that their call light's within reach, right? And you're charting that, like checked in on patient, da-da-da-da, call light within reach, bed in low position. And you can rewrite that same like couple sentence paragraph and just copy and paste it several times into your nurse's note, or you can go in and make several of these daily cares every 2 hours, whichever you prefer, whichever is easier for you. I personally think it'd be easier to do it in the nurse's notes. Because in real life, you're going to make sure you chart, especially on the safety stuff, just to really to protect your license, right? This kind of stuff, you only really need to chart on one time. Like if they're up ad lib, they're going to be up ad lib the whole shift, right? So if I'm independent, I'm just independent. You know, you don't need to chart on that every 2 hours. So just fill it in once, right? So this mobility part, you can just fill that in one time. You don't need to do that several times. Let's see, the nutrition, same thing. You don't need to chart on that every several hours. It's just gonna be the same. Like I'm independent feeder, I'm gonna be an independent feeder the entire day, You can put comments here, find like, oh, patient has a kosher diet, or maybe they're vegan or something. You can write that down. Hygiene, again, fill this out one time. Maybe you did a bed bath for this person. That'd be total dependence bathing. And you'd be like, total bed bath in the comments, you know, whatever. And maybe chart on specifically when you did that in your nurse's note, because that'd be important. But, you know, just charting that you did this one time. So the only thing you really need to make sure you do every 2 hours is this safety stuff. And that's really just to protect you and your license. So save that. And that's timestamped there. So again, you can go and create a new entry and fill out that safety thing every 2 hours, or just like write it out once in the nurse's note and then just copy and paste it. Okay. What else? Okay. Interventions, lines and drain. It's kind of a weird name for, you know, like IVs and chest tubes and Foleys, but it's under interventions for some reason. So this is where you'll find where to put like their IVs, their catheters, gastric tubes, drains, chest tubes, enemas, all those like things that are on the patient. So you can go and add an IV type. Most of them are going to be peripheral. You can put a comment there. Action. What about the IV? Are you inserting one? Or are you assessing it? Probably just going to be assessing it. You have to do an IV assessment, right? So assessment, where's the location? Let's say it's the forearm orientation. It's the right forearm. Site prep. We're not prepping a site because we're not inserting it. We're just assessing it. So what's the gauge? 22 gauge. You can tell by the color. The blue is 22. The green is 18. And the pink is 20. We're not inserting it, so we're not worried about attempts or any of that. Site assessment. Here we go. We want, do not put WDL, put clean, dry, intact, or maybe it's got some edema. Maybe it's draining. Whatever is appropriate. If there's any phlebitis or any of that. So then you would add that, right? And so that's been added. And if they have several IVs, you'll have to do it more than once, right? There's another one you can put in, because I pushed add again. Anyways, scroll down. If they have anything else filled out, save that. What else is on here? A lot of this is only applicable if it's applicable, right? So if your patient has restraints, you'd fill that out. Most of them don't. If they have any respiratory interventions, that's probably going to be more relevant. Like if they get an albuterol nebulizer treatment, or, you know, a lot of times you'll see respiratory go into a room and you can go in there and chart some respiratory interventions. If they're on a ventilator, I guess they don't have nebulizers on here. But if you do trach care, that's where you'd put that, you know, comments like trach care done, sterile technique. Let's see, what else am I missing? We can minimize those flow sheets. Screenings, I don't think we have to do any of those screenings. I can ignore those. Ah, yeah, the MAR. Okay, so we have to chart on their medications. So the way you have to do that is you have to put in a patient order, right? So this is literally how it would be in a real hospital. So again, we wouldn't be the ones putting in the orders. It would be the providers, unless we're putting in like a verbal order that we got over the phone, or a doctor, you know, gives us a telephone order, then we can put in an order, but we can't just make up an order ourselves. So you go to orders, new order, because they're not going to be able to chart that you gave any medications, because there won't be anything on the MAR until you put stuff in. So select an order. You have to start typing something. So it's like, okay, maybe one of their medications is Colace. And so the docusate sodium. So docusate capsules, that's the name of the med. We can just leave this the way it is, written order, Bernard Robinson. I don't really care because we don't know. So then we scroll down. The dose. What was the dose that was ordered for them? Let's say it was 100. And then you have to click a unit. Capsules. We're not giving them 100 capsules, right? It is a capsule, but we're not giving them 100 of them. We're giving them 100 milligrams, right? There's no rate because it's not an IV. Route is going to be oral. Frequency, that's like how many hours. So, you know, every 4 hours, every blah, 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 blah. PRN, once daily, two times daily. Let's go with BID. Sure. For how long? Don't worry about that. End date. Don't worry about that. Maybe admin instructions would be like, patient, takes with applesauce, or maybe it's one of those pills that you can't cross. You put that there or something like that. And then you push sign to sign that order. All right, so now it'll show up here. You know, your docusate sodium, 100 milligrams BID oral, right? So now that will show up under your MAR. And then you can document that you gave it. So you click on the time, right? And let's say I gave it at 5 p.m. You just click that box. And then it's going to, obviously you can't scan the patient. So just give a reason. That's, you can click on whatever reason you want. Doesn't matter. Submit. Actions. Obviously it's going to be given, right? So you're only going to put in the orders for the meds that you gave while in clinical, right? So a lot of patients will be on like 100 meds. I don't expect you to chart on like 100 different meds and put in all the orders for that. Just do the ones that you were, that they were, that they received while you were there. So that would just be like their morning meds, or if they have, you know, afternoon meds. Okay, date and time. You clicked on when you gave it, so you shouldn't have to change it in here, but you can if you accidentally click the wrong time. Dose should be the same as what's over here, right? Dose 100 milligrams, no rate. Comment, taken with applesauce or whatever. And then update. And now it'll show at 5 o'clock it was given, and those are my nurse initials right there. So you'll have to do that process, putting in the orders for all the meds and then documenting that they were given. I think that should be most everything. Maybe a few more things. Patient education. So this is good if, you know, you see a need for a patient, if like you're educating them on how to use an incidence spirometer or something like that. So the learner would be the patient. Factors affecting ability to learn. So maybe I have a culture barrier or hearing vision. I'm just gonna put no barriers. Preferred method of learning, we'll just say explanation. And then comments would be like, educated about how to use incentive spirometer, right? So then you can go more detail if you want, but you can then just save that. If something, if an opportunity like that pops out. I think you have to do this, an educational piece, and I think maybe adult one or two or something. So that's where you would find that. And then care plans. You will eventually be doing care plans later on in the semester. So you'll click this. And there's nothing here, so you have to put new problem, right? And so you'll just have these open boxes to do your typing. So first thing, I don't know why they don't do the diagnosis first, but I feel like this should come before the assessment, but that's fine. So this is where you're going to put your nursing diagnoses, right? We're not doctors, so we can't give medical diagnoses. So like, for example, if someone has COPD, as a nurse, I can't be like, you have COPD, right? Because I'm not licensed to say that. But I can say you have, what is it, like compromised airflow or impaired oxygenation or perfusion or something like that. You can also, there's several nursing diagnoses, and I can give you guys lists of that. Can't spell. So like, let's say my nursing diagnosis is risk for infection. All right, that's a common one. And then that's what goes here, is the nursing diagnosis. And then assessment is everything that you assess in that patient to prove that they have that diagnosis, that they have this nursing diagnosis. So why do I have risk for infection? Well, I have multiple open wounds, abrasions from my car crash, right? My white blood cell count is elevated. It's, I think I put 15, right? So don't just say elevated. Tell me what it is. Maybe I had a fever of 101.6. Maybe I had recent surgery, which is also a risk for infection. Maybe I have one of those external fixations to keep my bones in line. So that's definitely a risk for infection. So this is all the things about me about your patient that proves that this nursing diagnosis is relevant. Outcomes and planning is really just your goal. Okay, so what's your goal? has to be something measurable. So you can't just say gets better, because right, I'm like, well, how do you know if they got better? Like, what are you looking at? So let's say temp within normal limits, right? White blood cell within normal limits. What else? You know, just various things that are measurable. So like you can measure what their temp is. You can measure their white blood cells. Interventions. What are you going to do to help bring about these goals? Well, maybe they're going to get antibiotics. Maybe you're going to do hand washing. Maybe you're going to do PPE. I don't know. Whatever it is you're going to do. Evaluation is just, are they getting better? It's like, well, maybe their temp went down after several hours to 100.1, right? Or that's not a point, 0.1. So that shows that it's getting better. You can leave that blank and then save, and that's your care plan. Easy peasy, and then I can just click on it, and there it is. I think that's it. I think that's pretty much it. Let me just check one more time. Daily care, eyes and nose. If they have any wounds, you can put it there. If they receive blood, most of the rest of it is just patient specific. But that should be a good intro orientation to how to use EHR Tutor. And then when you're done, you just return to courses and view activities, and then it'll pop up. So you can see that this is the patient that I submitted. And if you want to keep working on it, you just click it again. And you just click the patient that you were working on, and it'll take you right back to the chart, and just make sure you save everything. And that's pretty much that. So hopefully that was helpful. If you have any specific questions, ask or leave it in the comments, and I'll do my best to help you guys out.